Hello, everybody. Welcome to a sort of uncommon special edition of Radiorama, where normally I show you how to restore radios primarily and other electronics that run on tubes. I've had a few people comment, perhaps I could slow down a little bit and show you the basics of how to restore these guys. So if you're a old timer and you've done 5 billion radios, this is going to be a little bit boring because I'm going to go into detail about the in and outs and basics of recapping and fixing a radio. This is a perfect candidate. This is a 1951 model Emerson 695. It is classically what we refer to as an all-American 5, and it has 5 tubes, as the name would suggest, and there's nothing that is out of the ordinary here. We have a 35W4 for the rectifier, a 50C5, and a couple of 12-volt tubes that are in the IF-RF sections of the circuit. Now, why do we call... These are called generically a hot chassis set, even though realistically it's a floating hot chassis. And the genius behind this design is there's no transformer. On many other sets that are more expensive, or sets that were earlier, you'd have a transformer where 110, 120, whatever would come in, and then it'd have several sections, like either a 6 or a 12 volt section for the filaments, and then a separate section for the high voltage. And that was more expensive to manufacture, and so the All-American 5, you combine all of the filaments together and you get about 110 volts. And these strings, it's like a Christmas light string from the 30s. All the filaments are tied together. If one goes out, they all go out. But that way you can eliminate the need for a transformer. And there's some safety considerations that we should talk about, and we'll get into that later. Meanwhile, it looks like someone unceremoniously cut the power cord, so I can't test it. And if you're new to working on radios, you probably shouldn't do that anyway. It's never a good idea. You could blow something up. If you've watched my channel before, I'm definitely not as careful with that. But first thing first is that we're going to remove the chassis, and I'm trying to figure out how this clock goes in here. I'm guessing maybe it's separately connected via an electrical cord. This stuff on these hands is either radium or tritium. By the time the 50s came around, they were using a much less amount of radium. That said, you know, usual safety protocols will apply. The danger is in possibly inhaling radium, because then it gets lodged in your lungs and then it wants to bind with your bones. And it's usually a problem when you have disintegration and you don't have a protective cover. This has both protective cover and the hands, the paint's in really good shape. See, if this had been older and had more radium, that paint would have turned brown from being literally burnt alive by the radium. So just be aware of that. If you're not comfortable working on such a thing, you don't have to. Anyway, I remember one time we did get a Geiger counter, and it only registered anything when I was right up against it. So anyway, so let's take the back off and see what's going on inside, and then we'll remove the chassis and see what's going on under the hood, which is where we're going to be doing most of our work. Okay, so I just pulled 3 bolts out of the bottom of the cabinet. Here's the chassis, and here's our 5 tubes. Now, a lot of people, when they first start working on these, are like, oh, it doesn't work, I need to replace a tube. Most of the time, it's not the tubes that are the problem. Most of the time, it's actually what's underneath, which is your capacitors, more particularly your electrolytic capacitors. So let's take a look underneath here, and we will, first of all, remove the dust bunnies. But there are several different critical capacitors that are inside of these sets. The most critical one, well, there's several critical areas. The most important one is the cap that goes to chassis ground. And I can already see this is that cap. Now what this does is imagine that your one end of your incoming AC line goes to all the different edges in the filaments, and in the other side you have to have a ground to go back to the other side of the AC cord. So what they did in some sets is they would just literally have the metal chassis be crown. But that's really dangerous because then you would have live AC on that chassis. So to diminish that shock hazard, they put a capacitor between the other end of the AC line and ground. Back then, I don't think they quite understood what little it takes to cause a heart to fibrillate. This is on the bare outside. Well, it's within the threshold, but you would still get kind of a nasty little shock. So we'll replace that with a safety cap. But before we do that, we need to replace the filter caps because I'm assuming most likely they're already bad. And electrolytic capacitors are very different than, say, the rest of these, which are a film cap. These have no polarity. Polarity meaning positive and a negative. Your electrolytics do. They have a positive and a negative. And this style of capacitor is a cardboard tube that has values written on it. We see 50 microfarads, just two of those. And the color-coded wires are your positives, and oftentimes the colors fade. That used to be red. This is green, and then your black is almost always your common ground. So think of it this way. There's two caps inside of here, one, two. They both use the same ground, which is this juncture here. So we're going to go ahead and replace this, and we can test to see if we have action. And I'm also going to, of course, have to replace this power cord so we can get power to the set. Now, to replace these, we need to use two modern replacements. Just to give you an idea how much technology has improved with capacitors. These are two 47 microfarad, 160 volt rated capacitors. And when it comes to replacing electrolytics, if the value is at or above, you're fine. Not to an excessive degree. Like if you go like say 100 microfarads here, which will be kind of stupid, you put a little bit more pressure on the rectifier when it fires up. I mean, it's not maybe the biggest end of the world because these tubes in this guys are like a dollar each or whatever. But I'm going to replace both of these 50 microfarad caps with two 47 microfarads. It's okay if it's a little bit below. These things are not exactly fine-tuned instruments. And what you do is you clip these leads and then mount your positives to as close of that positive as you can. And what I mean by that is we don't want to have loose dangly crap floating all over the place. So I'll install those and then I'll show you what that looks like when it's completed. Okay, welcome back. Day two working on the set. I had some stuff I had to take care of yesterday so I couldn't work on this very long. But we see we have our two electrolytic capacitors installed. Here's our two positives and they have the shared common negative here. And I try to mount them as close as I can so that they don't move around a whole lot. I also replaced the cord. And last night before I went inside, I did test the set. And I'm getting basically no filament at all. Like these should be lighting up, especially that 12AV6. I should be seeing some sort of filament, but I get nothing. So that means one of several things. Either we have a fault in the circuit, like a shorted resistor or something like that that's preventing filament voltage from getting to the tubes, or we have a bad tube. So if you are new to this, then you probably don't have a tube tester, and tube testers, especially good ones, can be expensive. Luckily, the museum I volunteer at sold me to this at a discount. This is a Hickok model TV7. It's a military-grade tester built like a tank. They retail for about $700 to $1,000. If you're going to do this either for a living or for a real serious hobby, it's worth every penny because they're good. If you don't have a tube tester, you can get these online for cheap, or you can go online because there's a lot of it, the data posted. This is a tube manual, and what it does is it shows all of your configurations and your data about your different tubes. And if you want to do a real quick test to see if one of your tubes has a bad filament, for example, I'm looking at the 35W4. This is known as a half-wave rectifier. and we look at the pins, the pins referring to, I'll pull one out so you can look at it. Pins referring to these guys, and the way you count them is you go usually from, if you're looking at it from underneath, you go this direction, 1, 2, 3, 4, and so on until you get to the gap here, which is noticeable. And according to this, pins 3 and 4 are H, which stands for heater, which is your filament. So you'd want to get your multimeter. Ideally, you know, you want to use one of these guys. And when I'm doing a continuity test, I for some reason prefer to use an analog meter. This is a Simpson. But in this case, I'm going to, since I have the tube tester here, the other thing that's key when you're testing a tube is not just the filament, but the emission. Because what goes inside in here is the filament is going to, quote unquote, emit electrons, and then they will be either positively or negatively attracted to or repelled to or repelled against these plates. And that's what gives you your, quote unquote, electron cloud. And I have already set up my tester for this tube, 35 volts. And then I just followed everything that shows on this chart here. ET05070, so ET05070. Select function switch is A, and I know that 7 is when you test rectifiers. Let's go ahead and put it in the machine and see what happens. Oh, well, it'd help if I plugged the tube tester in. All right, so now we're on. And I'm not really seeing a filament, but then again, it's kind of hidden underneath the carbon deposits, the silvering up here. Let's do a test here. That tube is dead. Sometimes if that happens, I make double sure that my tests or my settings are right. 35W4, 35ET0, ET0. 5070, test on the function A switch number 7. Nope, it's dead. So, luckily I have a whole bunch of other tubes here that I can test. 35W4s. 35W4s tend to go bad somewhat frequently because they are beat up pretty bad. The other thing you want to do is you want to test for shorts. This appears to not have any shorts. It's a good tube. So I'm not going to bore you with all the details, but I'm going to go through all of these tubes and see which one has got the open filament. Okay, well, there was a bad rectifier. I replaced that. And I'm not going to power it up again because I just don't want to risk damaging it, but we're getting a loud hum here. And while I was in here, I did something which is really critical. And again, this is a newbie kind of thing. One of the first things you want to check is whether or not you're getting good B+, meaning your DC voltages coming off your new electrolytics. I measured those and they were measuring fine, which tells me that there's something happening probably between the rectifier and the rest of the set. And I'm looking here and I've got two capacitors. Of course, these are both the originals. And there's not many capacitors to replace, and it won't take that long to do anyway, but probably have a shorted cap in here. This resistor, which is kind of acts like a fuse, it's an 18 ohm resistor. That one was getting smoking hot. This one is a 1500 ohm resistor. It measures fine. It's not getting hot. So it's around here. That's where the problem is. I'm going to place, you know, these two, and while I'm at it, this one, which is the safety cap that I've mentioned before, in which case you should use, I clumsily dig one out of my drawer over here, you should use this, which is a, let's see if I can get the close-up of the copy here because I always get it wrong, Y2X1 across the line rated cap. These will split open if they're, you know, hit by lightning or whatever. We're going to replace that with this, and then we have a bumblebee cap. These guys are awful. This is probably serving as the across-the-line cap. It's 47,000 picofarads, or 0.047 microfarads, and there's another guy underneath it. Usually they'll have their values written on the sides like this. This is upside down, but you see it says 0.02 MF, which is microfarads rated at working voltage is 400 volts DC. It's like this guy's shooting out the ends too. Yep, they all need to be replaced. So we will replace those with modern equivalents. So for example, I have a 0.047 cap you want to get. This is a 0.047 cap rated at 630 volts. These will last forever. They don't leak or anything like that. So even if your set works, you should replace all of those with the appropriate corrected caps. These guys are kind of loosely engineered. They don't really care necessarily about the value. But if you want to stick within factory spec, keep the value, you know, the voltage, I always recommend 630. And then the percentage as far as being within spec of value is about 15 to 20%. All right, so all the caps have been replaced. We have a total of four. These are a safety grounding cap, 0.01 rated cap. These two, and then that one. And so I was curious, I took them over to my cap checker, my old Telemic cap checker, and this guy was shorted hard. So that probably was causing a conundrum with the rectifier. So let's go ahead and plug it in. See if we get some improvement out of it. First, let's see if we got filament, which we do. I'm going to keep an eye on that little resistor there just in case it starts to smoke. I don't hear the hum that was associated with it. Now it works. The volume pot is clearly really filthy. This tuning thing is a little difficult to move, but we can fix that because all it's going to require is a little bit of touch-up and oiling. But I'm going to turn the chassis over and I'm going to clean it. And it's not necessary, but I mean, look at all those dust bunnies. Kind of a shame not to, wouldn't it? Radio's 60-something years old. It deserves a little cleanup after that time. Okay, so I cleaned all this up. I just took it outside and used a paintbrush. This has a galvanized coated chassis, which is better than the typical cadmium that they use. But there's no corrosion on this either, so it's in remarkably good shape. Now, the last thing I'm going to do as far as getting the proper radio restoration done is I'm going to inject some lubricant in the bearings of this tuning condenser. That'll just make it move a lot easier. I'm going to do it on both sides. And then just gently oil any of the other areas that might need it. I don't like that. It's just rubbing against that thing. Looks like I sure as hell got this string wet with oil. Need to wipe that off. No good. You don't really want to soak your dowel string in WD-40 just like I did. But it's on there pretty tight. So just give it a few more squeezes. There we go. Now, it's already moving much, much, much better. Now you just work it back and forth a little bit until that new oil works into its place. All right, so what I'm going to do now is clean the chassis. This is, it's not Bakelite. It's not polystyrene. I'm not sure what it is, but it's in really nice shape. I like the design. Sometimes if I get a radio that's really freaking boring and it's also white or brown, I'll sometimes repaint them. Not this guy. This guy has such nice styling. Not going to do it. So you want to use a mild detergent. And what I do is I'll come over to, I have a sink out here in my garage. And since it's all plastic, you're not going to hurt it getting wet. What I'll do first is get it a little wet. Then use that mild detergent. And I keep a paintbrush out here as well. I'm doing this one handed. I'll do a better job once I put the phone down. But you want to get into all these little nooks and crannies and shit. And then hose it off with warm water. And let it dry out in the sun. All right, now that the electronics is done and I cleaned the case, I'm going to polish it up with some of my favorite product. Novus number 2 plastic polish. Note to self, buy more. Just about out of it. That'll take care of both the plastic case and the clock dial cover, which is a little bit abraded. Actually, it might be some discoloration inside too. Oh, it's just condensating. The stuff is still drying. Anyway, I save up all my old socks and underwear, and I use that for polishing. And so, it takes, I don't know. Usually I do it at the end of the day when I'm kind of tired and I just want to sit in the rocking chair. And then I'll just kind of take it easy and be patient. All right, well, the case turned out pretty good. It's nice and clean. It's a little bit shinier, as did the cover for the clock. It's kind of hard to tell because it's white. But anyway, the last thing I'm going to do over here is install an optional feature. And that optional feature is the ability to add audio inputs through your set. So right now it's just a radio, which is fine if you like AM radio. That's okay, but if you live in most parts of the US, there's not much on AM anymore. It's either news, talk, religious stuff. I don't know. If that's your thing, great. But anyway, we're going to add audio input and make it safe, because even though this is a floating hot ground or a floating chassis, there still is the possibility that the user could get a little bit of current through the incoming audio line. And so what we're going to do is install this, which is called an isolation transformer. Now, it's not really rocket science. Think of it this way. If you have a wall wart in your house, you know, something that, for example, you use to charge your phone with, incoming primary, of course, is 120 volts coming out of the outlet, then the output's 12 volts. So we've got a primary winding and a secondary winding. And that action just basically isolates the user from harmful electrical or potential harmful electrical current. And there's several parts to this because we're going to be adding a stereo line in. And you know, the stereo is going to have two channels, right and left channel. So we'll want to make that mono so you'll pick up all the different parts of the music. And what we're going to do is run the right and left channels through either end of these two resistors that are 90 ohms. I usually go 90 to 200 ohms, doesn't really matter. And these terminate to one side, get off my fingers, of the secondary of the isolation transformer, which it doesn't matter, you can pick one of these. And then this goes to essentially either sides of the volume pot. And what I mean by that, and it's hard to actually film this because the volume pot is buried under stuff, there's three prongs. There's a center, and then a top, and then a bottom. And the bottom is your negative, and then your top is usually the incoming RF signal. These are the wires that are coming from the volume pot. One of them goes to the first IF transformer, and so that's our top. That's the top of the pot. And then the other one, I'll need to trace it out, but I believe, where does it go? It goes to the same ground as the electrolytic, so that's definitely the other side of the pot. So process elimination, that's where we will run our line coming in from the primary side of the isolation transformer. And then what we'll also need to do is make sure that we can switch the IF signal on and off. So what I'll do is I'll run a switch. This is so buried. This leg of the RF transformer out the back of the cabinet, and then I'll already got holes, and then I have a little switch that turns the RF signal on and off to clean up the audio so you don't have radio interference coming in. It's very easy to undo, so I know some of the guys that wanted to have it be done perfectly to original won't like this, but look at it this way. This thing will probably be a shelf queen if I do nothing else to it. By adding audio input, you can actually play whatever you want on it, and so it gives it a new chance to become useful again, or more useful than it is right now. Okay, so we have our audio device installed. We have our right and left channels running together. Then we have our ground. This is our secondary of the primary, and the primary of the isolation transformer goes to both the top of the pot, which is the incoming RF signal, and then the negative, which is common negative for the electrolytics. Then we have a switch wire that comes out of the back, and that is our connection between the top of the pot and this leg of the RF transformer. So it's pretty much done. I do tend to tie a knot in my incoming audio cords and put a little glue so they're not going to push through or anything like that, and they won't chafe if someone yanks on it. But let's put the back on, and also what I'll need to do is, of course, run the switch through the back and cut the line to length. You want to make this as short as possible. We'll put it back in the cabinet, and hopefully she will be a done radio. Now it's time to do final reassembly. Just wanted to give you a couple more tips before I do this. The number one thing is that a lot of these came with a compressed fiberboard back. And, you know, sometimes with age they can deteriorate a little bit. And so what I have found is if you want to add a little more structural rigidity to it, is I'll take the back off. And I used a water-based polyurethane. I just glop it on both sides. It really stiffens it up, and it also seals up the paper so it's not going to deteriorate anymore. So now the other thing is, when you do run your switch wire out for the audio, you want to keep it as short as you possibly can to prevent any sort of unnecessary noise pollution from getting into the set or getting into the sound. So we're all cleaned up, got my knobs cleaned up, we've got the case and the clock cover all polished up. So after I run this little switch to the back, probably right here, be ready to put it back together again. Before I stick it back in the case, this is a kind of an additional safety test that I do. It's to confirm what the potential current potential off the chassis is if I were to ground it out. And so one of our members built this little box, and that's connected to my multimeter up here. My threshold is 0.6 on this scale. And I have a polarity reverser. So the set is already on. I'll touch the chassis ground. That's probably in the neutral position. That's measuring nothing, 0.008. Let's flip the polarity. 0.3. So we're a little over half of the value of our max. That's pretty good. Now the other test I'm going to do is a resistance leakage test on this megger over here. I don't have it. Let me see if I have it turned on here. Yep, it's turned on. I got to caution you guys, if you're going to use one of these, just know that it can potentially carry a lot of juice on it, and you can get shocked. So just be aware of that. Make sure you always discharge it. Oh, and make sure your set is on. So what I'm going to do is attach one end of the megger to my positive, well, of one of the prongs off my plug. And I'm going to set the multiplier for 1 at first. I'm going to start test voltage at 100 volts. I've got to wait for my light to turn on. My charge is now built. And I'll touch the ground of the set. I get nothing. Let me bring it up to 500 volts. Just get a little bit of a blip. Multiplier at max. That's good. That's basically nothing. So we're good. Again, make sure you always discharge your megger, because it does hold a charge. All right, we're ready for reassemblage. Okie dokie. It's all buttoned up back together again. And usually what I do in these guys is I let them play for a while, because once you put it back in the case and it gets nice and warmed up all the way, you could potentially have a component failure. Maybe something's going to open up from heat. So you want to run it for a few hours if your intention is to release it back in the wild again. Anyway, I've got my little Bluetooth running through the audio. I've heard worse. It's not bad. It'll be a good little kitchen radio. And if I want to listen to the radio, all I have to do is disconnect the little Bluetooth and flip the little switch in the back, and we get radio.
Since 1985, we shop. Hey, get full details on the example policy. It's leftboat.com/commercials or click. Keeping it's tough.
Anyway, this radio doesn't seem to like the myriads of LED lights I have in my garage here. Every time I take these back to the museum, they work on radio about five times better because we don't have so much noise coming through. Anyway, like I said, I let it run for a while, and I'm not sure if this was the best beginner's video. I tried to slow down a little bit, but if you are new to this, and I hope you learned something about it. And just a word of advice, if you do not feel comfortable working on electronics, then you shouldn't do it. If if you want to seek advice, there's plenty of forums out there, the Antique Radio Forum, and you can ask as many questions as you want. Just tell them that you're new, and you'll find that most people are really happy to help you. Safety is key, and so just make sure that you know what you're doing. Anyway, thanks so much for watching, and if you have any questions or comments, you can leave them down in the comments section below. Otherwise, probably got a few more radios to work on. And until next time, see you later.